Well, welcome to this very exciting morning. I think there's a conspiracy because it's a such an early morning colloquium and they don't put any coffee or tea there. So you may be feel free to doze off, I guess. So welcome. Today our speaker is Qian, our very own staff member here. Qian got his bachelor degree in physics from Peking University, and then he qualified for a very prestigious and very competitive scholarship called COSPIA and went to University of Maryland for graduate study. And then he got his PhD from Maryland in physics. Then he went to University of Michigan, where I first met Qian, first as a postdoc fellow, and then as an assistant research professor there. Working on tidy and FPI optical design, as well as tidy data retrieval and analysis. And then he joined NCAR in 2000. His main research is to study the upper atmosphere physics using ground-based and satellite observations. His FPI instruments can be found from the Arctic to the Antarctica. So some FPI information today from Qian.
All right, thanks, Hanley. And thank you for everyone stay here. And this morning, I almost left, you know, that they ought to evacuate this building here. So, today I just give you a sort of overview of what I have done here at the HAO and over the more than 10 years here. And just give you an outline of what I'm going to talk about. First, say something about motivation. Oh, here we go. And then I'm going to say, describe what wing observations are made, how the wing observations are made, and then talk about a balloon wing experiment, balloon-borne wing experiment. And I spent a lot of time on the satellite observations, timed, and so I'm going to say something about that. And I also have done quite a bit of work working with the community models, like TI-EGCM, so. And then we're going to talk about the future plans I have. So this picture you've probably seen quite a few more times. And this is a picture they produced when they work on the TIDY program. And the region we are interested in is above 100 kilometers to all the way up there. And for many of the people working in the lower atmosphere, this place probably is not that interesting, but this is a place is not a void, and it has a lot of things going on in there. It has neutrals, ions, and due to the solar UV radiation. And these ions are called ionosphere, and they have a large impact on GPS, satellite communications, or other things. So we're interested in the region. This is because ionosphere does change a lot from time to time, and due to various reasons, and we call that space weather, and they have impact on GPS, as I said. One of the key parameters of this region is the winds, and from mesosphere to thermosphere, all the physics you want to understand this region here, you need to know the winds in there. And so wind is an important parameter for understand this region here. Now, how do you measure winds? Winds are measured usually by remote sensing of a phenomenon called air glows. And this is a vertical profile of atomic oxygen air glows. This is due to excitation by a free electron collision with atomic oxygens. And this is in the thermosphere. And in the mesosphere and lower thermosphere, there are a few other air glow emissions allow you to look at. And what happens is that these air glows are Doppler shifted by the winds. They're moving along with the molecules, whatever atoms emitting these emissions, they're moving along the winds, they Doppler shifted. And if you can measure the Doppler shift of this air glow, these air glows, then you can get winds in these regions. And there are three emissions we usually commonly used from this air glow, and we use one is the OH emissions, hydroxyl emissions. These come from 87 kilometers. Another one's the old green line we called 97 kilometers. Another one I just mentioned is a red line emissions from 250 kilometers. How do you measure the air glows? There are two ways to do that. One is from a spacecraft that's called a LIMS scan. And this is the air glow layer above the Earth. And if you have a spacecraft here, you're looking along the limb, and you can sample various altitudes going up, scan these altitudes, and obtain the winds at different altitudes. This is one way. And this is a more expensive way. A cheaper way to do it is on the ground, and you can looking up from, I have a ground-based instrument, and you're looking up from different directions with elevation angle like 45 degrees. And in our case, we usually sample five directions, north, south, east, west. And based on the, with another assumption that the vertical winds usually is very small, much smaller than the horizontal winds. And they can divide by cosine, whatever, 45 degrees, get the horizontal winds. Yes?
You have a question about the place. I assume that's derived from temperature?
Yes.
And how variable is that? It's a very night-day solar cycle?
They do vary a little bit, but for example, like red line emissions, they usually stay pretty high. They don't go down below because that emission is called a forbidden line. And the upper state of that emission has a very long lifetime, like 100 seconds, something like that. And so you will quench. If you go down to lower altitudes, collision will deactivate whatever. So they wouldn't come from lower altitudes. So. And we have these kind of instruments setting up here, even in Boulder here. Over the years, we have built like a seven instruments here already. And this is the one in Boulder. The instrument is called a Fabry-Pérot, this one at Marshall Field in the trailer here. And the Fabry-Pérot, I don't want to get into too much detail of it. It's, in short, it is a very accurate spectrometer. You can measure the small, very minute Doppler shift in the airglow due to the wind, neutral winds. And these are the various spectrons, what we call the fringes, from the Fabry-Pérot interferometer. And on the top here, this is a laser. Usually it's for calibration purposes. And this is the OH emission fringes, green line emission fringes, and this is red line emission fringes. And from Boulder, we do measure winds. And here, the winds from obtained from Boulder actually last year. Upwards, northward, the positive northward. This is a thermosphere winds from 250 kilometers. Very, very nice diurnal variations here. You go, always go to equator during the midnight. As a zonal wind, upwards eastward. And let's see. This is lower thermosphere winds from 97 kilometers. And you have seen this is a more or less a semi-diurnal tides here. And this time of year, usually you see a strong semi-diurnal tide at this latitude. And again, northward is up positive. And once you notice that this observation is only limited during the nighttime, there's a huge data gap during the daytime. It doesn't mean we do not want the daytime measurement. We need the daytime measurement. The difficulty, of course, is the daytime sun is up. These airglow signals are very weak, and it's very hard to pick up the signals. And these experiments have been done over the years by many people, and we are one of those groups doing this kind of experiment. So why the, now, here's the same challenge is, how do you do a daytime measurement? And just show you a diagram what the challenge is for the daytime measurement. If you want to do a daytime measurement of the airglow signals, the background's very high here. And this little bump here, that's an airglow signal for the red line emissions. It's only 2% above the background. So you're trying to sample something above very high background, you usually get very, very large wind errors because of background noise into it. On top of that, this background is not flat. It has a Fraunhofer structures in there. It's very hard to get rid of them. So the idea is that what is causing all the scatter? That's all the air you have. And the idea came to me that when we Charles working on this sunrise project, balloon project, say, you know, if you can go to, say, balloon height, and then all the airs are down below you, the scatter is going to decrease. So the scatter intensity is really proportional to the pressure you have. So say if you can go to, say, 40 kilometers, where the pressure is only a thousandth of on the ground, your scatter is only a thousandth of what you have ground. Then you can see the scale here. Here is a 2% above the background. Now, if you can reduce the background by a factor 1,000, then this signal is 20 times above the background. Then that signal is much stronger relative to the background. You can easily pick out the thing. So just show you what the stratosphere balloon looked like. And this is one in the stratosphere. And it's a very nice shot with the balloon in there. And really, if you go to the stratosphere, it's really dark. And here's what the Alan Stern thinks, how dark it is. This is the one, he's a commercial balloon flight ventures pictures. It's very dark. And here's a gondola here. And even so, he even thinks that you can see stars, you know, that on his capsules there in the stratosphere balloon. So what we did is we did analysis on this based on the information we have for the how much background you have. And if you're riding on a balloon, how high you want to ride a balloon in order to get good signals out of it. And we did a simulation on this. And based on the background intensity and you estimate wind errors, if you want to measure the winds picking up the signals, on the ground, you probably get the wind errors above like 100 meters per second with integration time of 100 seconds. But if you say you go to 40 kilometers, where the scatter intensity is only a thousandth of what you have on the ground, where you can have theoretically only about 2 meters per second wind errors, which is very nice. So we wrote a proposal to NASA and say we want to do this experiment. And a panel gave a very hard remark, and very fortunate, you know, that get funded. And so we went ahead, built this instrument. This is a instrument for the balloon FPI experiment called the High Wind, stand for High Altitude Interferometer Wind Observations. And on the top is a sky scanner. What it is, it's a rotating mirror, allow you to looking at four directions. Because it's on the balloon is overhead, so you cannot looking vertical anymore, so we're only looking at four directions. So make it simpler, just have one mirror rotating around, looking at four directions. Below that, there's a filter wheel, allow you to select different emissions if you want to choose to. And below that, it's an Edlon chamber, that's where the FabiPiro stays, and the focus lens and the camera. This whole thing is enclosed in what they call the pressure vessel. This pressure vessel maintains a 1 atmosphere pressure and allow the instrument to function correctly. So we built this instrument and we shipped to a site in northern Scandinavia called Kiruna. That's a launch site for NASA. And here's me working on the instrument in Kiruna in the experiment. Of course, not everything goes smoothly all the time. And looks, this guy is looking very seriously, and something is not right, probably. And you really like to have someone like Alice working for you. You know, looks concentration Alice has shown here, you know, that really working hard. And finally, everything seemed to working, and looks everybody is happy now. And then guys putting the things together, putting into the gondola. And on June 14th, 2011, we're ready for launch from Kiruna. And it's a launch vehicle, this is our whole thing. And we have a GPS compass on top of it, and that allow you to maintain pointing of this the gondola to within 1 degree, and the solar panels, various other things in there. This is the moment when the balloon lift off, and they release the balloon here, and the balloon will go vertical. Then this launch vehicle will release the balloon payload, and then it'll go to the sky, as shown in this picture here. And below here, this is a parachute here, and this is for recovery. And when the time's right, when they decide to recover the payload, the NASA will send the command, will cut off the balloon, will go, and the parachute will catch the payload, drop onto the ground. So it'll capture that. This just gives you some sense of scale with the balloon size of we have. On the ground, because the pressure is high, they squeeze the balloon into small volumes here, and it's about like 900 feet tall. It's a 40 million cubic feet balloon, and called a 40 light. when you're into a stratosphere, this is a zero pressure balloon. The pressure inside is the same as outside. The balloon will expand with this old helium inside, and it's about like a 700 feet, and it's like a pumpkin shape. Parachutes here, and capture that. So of course, the balloon flew with a stratosphere winds, and when you launch in the summer in the northern Scandinavia, you flew from across the Atlantic, and in 4 days, it reached northern Canada. And then that's time when you cut down the balloon, and a parachute will take it and reach down to the balloon, and we recover the balloon. And so after all this things, what do you got with this experiment? And this is what we got. Thermosphere winds at 250 kilometers. Once is notice there's no large data gaps during the day. By the way, I should mention this is during the whole period is during daytime. This is in the northern summer, and this is all white night. Everything's during the day. And the wind air we got is about like 15 meters per second, even though the background, theoretical background is pretty low, but there are other scatters from balloon and everything else. I can still get into it. So background is still higher than the nighttime. So the next thing what you should do is maybe looking at what the model tells you, because at NCAR we do quite a bit modeling effort for the upper atmosphere. So here's a TIEGCM, stands for Thermosphere, Ionosphere, Electrodynamics, Circulation Model. It's developed by Ray Robo and Art Richmond, everybody, a lot of people at HAO. And this is a vanilla version of it, and nothing, the standard run, and this red line here. And these regions, they seem to be okay, but in this daytime region, by the way, Corona is about 1 hour after Greenwich time, so it's local time, noon is around here, during the 12 here. And you can see the winds are basically opposite. And as we said earlier, northward, positive is northward. Northward means a poleward during the daytime. This reading here. Now, why this discrepancy here? And so you can look at this plot in a vector form, and you can look at this way here. So what this one is that the blue, of course, is high wing observation. The red is a TIGCM. And here you do the measurement, and sun is over here, and day night terminal is somewhere over here. So in a sense, the model is it makes sense because the sun is over here, the daytime, and the pressure is high in this region here, and nighttime is over here because this is dark here. And you need a terminator, so the pressure gradient should be pushing the winds into the pole, should be positive northward. And for reasons which I could talk about, we see this observations, winds are really blowing sort of unexpected, equivalent, all the way to the equivalent. All around, it's nothing coming into the polar cap all the way. Yes.
So the TIEGCM, if you were running, that was the tidy,
or is it this is a vanilla, no tidies in there. This is a generic one. Okay. So you have to look at this in a context of a magnetosphere footprints and over. Where we are in Corona is in the subauroral region here, and these various regions correspond to a region in the magnetosphere. And during the noontime, we're sort of equivalent of a cusp region called a cusp red here. And what is a cusp? Cusp is a region of magnetosphere that it's separating between the day side, closed field lines regions, and the night side, the magnetosphere, magnetic field lines blowing into the nighttime night side. And there's a region that you have a particle coming in, you have a constant reconnection happening on the day side. And so there's a lot of things going on. You have a particle coming in, all the other things. And recently, and Dolores Knepp has noticed that in the cusp region, you have a lot of energy flux coming in. And this is a DMSP observations she did, and she analyzed. And these regions have unusually large cusp heatings. And also another observation by Herman Lurer, using a CHAMP satellite. They saw very strong, large thermosphere densities in that region. What happens is that I think you have a lot of heating in the cusp and causing upwelling and a lot of mass moving upward and increase the densities when the spacecraft CHAMP satellite crossing over sees that. So what happens is that now these kind of things really changes the dynamics of the thermosphere on the day side near the aurora region. And it's not like a TIGCM does not have a cusp. It has a cusp. It has a precipitations. It just does not have enough precipitation energies into the cusp to change the things, wind directions. If you add more energy into the cusp, like I did in this case, if you add more energy into the numbers that the Dolores observed, you can get a very good agreement with observations. So the reason you have this kind of discrepancy is because the TIGCM does not have enough cusp heating. So you really need to add more cusp heating into it. Here's a balloon landed in Canada after 4-day flights, and we recovered the whole thing, and the balloon payload right now sitting in our CG3 lab waiting for another proposal to be funded to fly again, hopefully. And I have to give credit for all my team members, and these are the people who work very hard on the balloon payload, and we only have 3 people went to Kiruna, and we all work very hard on this. So next is another project I involved quite a bit long time with, and this is called timed thermosphere, ionosphere, mesosphere, energetic, and dynamics. This is NASA satellite project. It has 4 instruments, and it was launched in December 7th, 2001. December 7th, of course, is a Pearl Harbor Day. I always remember that. And I work on this for a long, long time, and at the beginning, and the way I built a simulator for this tidy instrument, and which allow us to sample various air globes to evaluate performance of the instrument and specify the instrument specs. Let's see. The instrument is a lens scan instrument, as I mentioned earlier, and it has 4 telescopes, and they have a fiber optical cable connected into the Fabry-Pérot, feed into this Fabry-Pérot interferometer. So it measures Doppler shift from 4 directions, and it allows scan various air glow emissions. During the daytime, there's another air glow we usually sample. That's the O2 atmosphere band, which is very strong. It's probably the strongest air glow you can find. And there's a lot of lights coming in. And this is the air glow we sample. And by the way, TIDE mostly samples lower thermosphere and the mesosphere region. And here's how we sample that lens scan, as I showed earlier. And as far as wind measurement, because it's vector, we have 4 telescopes, and how do we measure vectors out of this? When the spacecraft at position A here, they have 4 telescopes, and the telescope looking forward samples location C and E here. And in 9 minutes, the spacecraft move to this location B here. Then the backward-looking telescopes also samples location C and E here. And at the C and E, you can combine the 2 measurements forming a vector because it's measured at orthogonal directions. You can get a wing out, decompose into a meridional zonal wind out of that. And time has 2 measurement tracks on both sides of spacecraft. And this is a 1 orbit, and this is on what we call the cold side, facing away from sun. This is facing towards sun, it's called the warm side. And during the 1 day, it will sample 15. The spacecraft are orbiting the Earth 15 times, so you'll have 15 orbits around the Earth, and so you can sample the globe. And these are the, I believe this is the ascending node, descending node, and ascending node, descending node of the warm side, the cold side. You got various wind patterns from 90 kilometers, and you can see a lot of structures in there. And So really good, satellite spacecraft is good at sampling global scale waves. We can average a day, observation during one day and getting information out of that. This is meridional winds on the left, and this is the zonal winds on the right. And these features near the equator like a negative, positive, positive, negative, positive, negative. These features are typical diurnal tides, very strong diurnal tides, anti-symmetric diurnal tides in there. And here in the zonal wing, what you have is also diurnal tides. And in here, these features are usually what we call the semi-annual oscillations in there. And we can extract the amplitudes of the diurnal tides based on the tidy observations. These are the amplitudes from, this is semi-diurnal tides observations as well. These all published some years ago. And we can also compare with a model, Moore-Huggins global scale wave model. And on the phase, everything else, they give you very much similar results, but in terms of the amplitude, there's some offsets compared to what we have here. The amplitude is a little bit smaller. The semi-diurnal tides certainly have a little bit larger discrepancies, and over the years we have noticed that the diurnal tide simulation seems to be getting better results, and the semi-diurnal tides seem to be getting a larger disagreement, and I think Hanley can agree with that, that seems to be a problem. We also look at the interannual and seasonal variations of diurnal and semi-diurnal tide. Sorry for the busy plot here. This is the old diurnal tide at 95 kilometers. This is different years, 2002, 2003, 2004, 2005, 2006, 2007 here, and because this paper was published in 2008, so it doesn't have anything after that. And beginning of the year, end of the year here, and you can see there's a large enhancement during the equinox, spring equinox, and usually you should have another equinox enhancement in the fall, but usually it's a little bit less. And the way I'm plotting this in this format is another thing I want to examine is that the QBO effect on this diurnal tide. And these are the eastward face of a QBO. This is the westward face of QBO. And so you can compare the two sides. And there's a tendency that on the eastward side, the QBO and the diurnal tide is a bit stronger. And there's a lot of theories on whether due to the mean winds or gravity waves forcing this, and even various models give a different answers, so there's still questions to be investigated. On this side is a semi-diurnal tide, and this is a later publication, and so you can see more years of data onto it. And this is zonal wing, I believe, and also at 95 kilometers. And I highlight a few things here, and these are the things associated with a stratosphere warming event. And in 2002, we have a very unusual southern hemisphere stratosphere warming event. And for that event, we can associate with a large enhancement semi-diurnal tides in the southern hemisphere mid-latitudes. Another thing that's interesting is that in the northern hemisphere, we also see a decrease of semi-diurnal tide during that event. And compared to other years, you can notice that. And this is also being observed on the ground by ground-based observations. And these are the northern hemisphere stress warming events, and you can see enhancement of semi-diurnal tides. And stratosphere warming is also getting hot these days because become a hot topic these days because Larissa Gonchenyuenko find out that stratosphere has impact, warming event has impact on the ionosphere. So this is something we need to study more of. So now, after we get obtained all these data, we find something interesting that we can do another thing, that using this thing to drive the TIEGCM models. And TIEGCM at the lower boundary at 97 kilometers is driven by a GSWM most of the time. And now we have this observations. We thought, well, we have a better, more realistic results of the tides, and we can use this to drive the TIEGCM models, adding more favors to the TIEGCM. So this is a simulation. I wrote a proposal again, by the way, to NASA, and I got funded to do this. And so this is a simulation I did with a TIGCM result with a time lower boundary conditions. As you can see that this is a non-migrating type propagating into the thermosphere. And another thing that's nice about using a TIGCM to simulate non-migrating tides, various tides in the thermosphere is that this thing has all the ionosphere effects in there as compared to just using a half mode extension into the thermosphere, which doesn't contain much ionosphere effect into it. So. And this is a non-migrating tide at 250 kilometers. And you can see this is a simulation with a time boundary, lower boundary conditions. You can see the periodical oscillations in there. The one at lower is the panel is the one without this kind of features in there. So now how good are these results compared to observations? And indirectly, we can do some comparisons, and one of the visitors from Japan, Yamasaki, did some work with this, and they obtained very nice results, it turned out. And what he's trying to measure is magnetic signatures of ionosphere currents due to tides, and this is done in Africa, Ethiopia. And he can use in the model to calculate the ionosphere current and compare, then produce magnetic signatures. And here's some various runs he did, and TIGCM runs calculating the currents and the magnetic disturbances, and the green lines observations, and the red dash, long short dash line is the one without tides. Of course, that's a little bit short about the disturbance you can see. Blue is with a traditional GSWM simulations, and the black is one with a new timed lower boundary conditions. And of course, you can see the results much better, obtain much better results. So I believe this is probably due to a more of a accurate semi-diurnal tides in the lower boundary conditions from the timed results allow you to getting up to better results. So let's talk about a little bit about future plans, what I have. And I showed you this picture, and various Fabry Pierrot we have built. And also I heavily involved one that's Millstone Hill, which I'm the PI for that instrument. We also have quite a few pending proposals to deploy more instruments on the ground. And Chico, California, Eureka, Thule, and Sanya, Antarctic, few Antarctic stations, and Hawaii, which is. Here's just to give you a distribution of the FPIs we have. The red are the ones already been built or deployed, and we have two in China. There's Resolute here, and Palmer, we just deployed one in South Korean station called Jeonbogo, and Millstone Hill, Boulder here, and one thing in Africa is very interesting that we had a colleague here from Africa, Ivory Coast, and who was a Fulbright scholar here, and we know him for a long time. And this is very interesting that Ivory Coast, wrote a proposal to Air Force, and they funded us. And we really like to see working with his colleague from Ivory Coast and promote more research with us. Colleagues over there. If I have a chance in the future, I'd really like to build few more stations in the mid-latitude regions, like say maybe southern Spain, in Georgia, Tbilisi, or maybe Kashgar in West China someplace, and Azores in the Atlantic. Forming really long longitudinal chain in the mid-latitudes, looking at long non-migrating tides. And this is really nice because this allows you to see a non-migrating time much shorter time scale compared to a spacecraft measurement. Spacecraft data usually require a little bit longer time period to obtain the tides out. And of course, you can distribute as much as you can. Still a lot of places you cannot put FPI in there. So the coverage from ground-based observation is always limited in many ways. and you really like to still have a spacecraft observations. Here's one idea, is maybe putting on a space station, for example. I plot this one here, say, just sampling from a space station, suppose according to the space station orbits. And that'll give you fairly good coverage, not as high as a tidy, but still give you coverage most of the regions you can have. And you really need a combined observations from a spacecraft and the ground-based to get all the information out. And of course, you have to look at the big picture. And we got these, many of the things I've done is with NASA, and Decadal Survey is one sort of a Bible and you want to look at. So what's in the Decadal Survey, where the money went, and you can look at the chart here, and most time we're getting money from here, and there are other larger things here, and if we can collaborate with somebody and maybe get into one of these things, and for example, like this one here, it's called a geospace dynamic constellation, and that's very interesting thing. And to expand our coverage, and this is what idea of this thing, GDC is a six spacecraft in three orbital planes. And the spacecraft, I think, is 180 degrees apart in track angles. So it covers both poles simultaneously, and they give you all the local time coverage onto it. And it's, maybe you can get a wind instrument down there, what, I don't know, that kind of opportunities if you want to look into. Well, of course, we continue on to looking at a balloon experiment, and in the future, thinking about flying balloon in Antarctic. One advantage of in Antarctic is you can allow it to much longer time period. And on the left is the purple circle here is where the aurora oval is. And if you launch a balloon in Antarctica, say McMurdo somewhere here, allow it to circumnavigate the pole, and you can sample both inside the polar cap and all the equatorial regions, sub-auroral regions as well. So, and people using balloon to do experiment have shown they can really last for a long time. For example, like this one here is a Qian balloon experiment from NASA. It is probably the longest flight they had to circumnavigate the South Pole for three times, 45 days. So you can do the same thing here. You really got a good sample out of that. And one thing we like to interesting to know is that we have done experiment in the sub-auroral region, look at the cusp, and the green one's a standard TIGCM, and this one's with enhanced cusp. And if you even go to the polar side of the cusp, you can also see noticeable difference, like 100 meter per second differences there. So you really like to see cusp region, how the heating is affecting the winds on both sides of the cusp region. And maybe in the future, we can building a smaller instrument and to launch on a smaller super balloons. This is one experiment that the NCAR involved. It's a stratosphere balloon sampling gravity waves and drop zones in Antarctic. And we can maybe have a combined HAO and other EOL, ACD, whatever NCAR balloon experiment to launch quite a few of those flying around. Then you can even fly into the ocean, make it cheaper, you can disposable or something like that in the future. So so here's a summary. And as I said, you know, the wing observations are important, not only for scientific research, but also for practical applications as well. And these wings are needed, observations needed for validate the observations and improve community models, adding more favors to TIGCM as I have done in the past. And we have done quite some major pioneering work with our experiment, like a first ever balloon-borne daytime thermosphere wing observations. And the sub-auroral region observations can only be done with daytime instrument like at high winds. You cannot do with a ground-based instrument. So this is and finding the effect of the cusp heating on the thermosphere winds. We would like to continue to lead our in scientific research and technology advances, including developing new instruments, which would be suitable for remote sites, balloons, and spacecrafts. And I think we may be able to combine low atmosphere, upper atmosphere research together on the balloons, and thinking more collaborations in university communities. And that's it.
questions for Qian?
Yes.
The amount of energy that you needed to put into the cusp to get that reversal of the wind, was that consistent with the amount of energy? 170 milliwatts per square meter, I think you said. That sounds high.
That's what the Dolores has, I think I remember.
That is what Dolores had. Yeah. Was that a big event, or was that just sort of normal day-to-day?
It's a normal day. People always say, you only have one day data. You need more data to prove. I believe this is always like this. That probably more heating is going on all the time. But according to Dolores, only under certain conditions you have this kind of large flux. So I'm not sure. That's why I'm saying that we need to have more observations like this to see.
So are there times in the in the northern winter when you can actually make these observations from the ground in the same geographic region if you choose the right season?
For Kiruna, you always have a large daytime gap. Kiruna has an FPI, by the way. It's a ground-based FPI by University College of London. Anasoya Ulia has one over there. Over the year, do make observations. But there's still a daytime gap. At that latitude, you don't have daytime measurement.
Questions?
Continuing on the cusp question, what electron energy did you use? At what altitude?
I think I used the 200. I just increased the flux, whatever the energy. I didn't change the energy flux in there. I just changed the flux in there.
Yeah, I can't remember. Is it?
I think the 200.
200 EV.
200 EV.
Thank you.
First of all, thank you for a very nice introduction on current wind observations. Do you have any plans? You have almost 12 years of time data, like TIDI. Do you have any plans to create a climatology of winds like yours for modelers? Because we actually very drastically need this climatology of amplitudes of migrating, non-migrating tides, zonal mean flow, etc.
I'm a little bit short on time this year. I should have wrote a proposal to NASA to have this making a data product like a tidal amplitudes, all the other things, based on these observations. But I just came back from Antarctica. I was a little bit short of time on that. Maybe next year I will write a proposal, definitely do that.
Yeah, because this is very important work.
Yeah, we'll definitely do that. Yes.
And the continuation of these questions, basically, I didn't hear, do you have any systematic comparison between our radar system versus TIDI? Because this problem, differences of MF radar winds versus satellite winds around above 85 kilometers, and it's still, unfortunately, is not clarified. Do you have any plans, basically, to using satellite optical measurements to make some comments on the validity of ground-based wind measurements for validation of model and climatologists, etc.
That's an interesting topic. I think that has been a long-standing issue with a comparison between satellite and a ground-based measurement, and usually the meridional winds tend to be compare better than the zonal winds. Zonal winds seem to be always off. And of course, there's other issues like MF radar winds tend to be smaller than other winds. I think that being resolved now, I think that everybody understand that the MF radar winds tend to be smaller by nature. And they need to scale back up a little bit. And I would say yes, that's an interesting topic, and I was pretty sure that I haven't done much comparison with our FPI measurement with TIDI yet, but I'm pretty sure the ground-based FPI should be comparable with the spacecraft FPIs, and if not, then I'm in trouble, and I'm pretty confident that that should be agreeable, no problem.
All right, thank you.
Questions for Qian?
Question. So, yes, very nice colloquium. Question on your ground-based FBI measurements.
Yes.
There was a significant gap, in fact, no current or planned, in most of the southern hemisphere, except for Antarctica. What are the issues with getting ground-based instruments in the southern hemisphere?
Yeah, sorry. I only showed the one NCAR is involved. There are other groups also involved with the observations in New Zealand, in South America. And it all depends on the funding sources. We don't have enough-based support for that kind of activities. Most of the stuff is either NSF or Air Force or some other fundings, international fundings came from, so in some ways. We try to create more opportunities to collaborate with people. And I like to go to Southern Hemisphere, of course, that Africa has been a black spot, you know, for a long time. There's not much resources in Africa, you know, that we like to go there.
And is there anything limiting the balloons, or stratosphere balloons to high latitude? Can you launch at low or mid latitude?
NASA has a launch site in Australia, and they also start launching balloons from Hawaii as well. The difficulty here is that they don't last long. They usually last only a few hours. And most balloon program in NASA is tailored for two things, cosmic ray and astronomy. And we are sort of a very few space group, the atmosphere, of course, there's a few atmosphere. JPL has it some. But the another issue is that the balloon right now, NASA uses zero pressure balloons. They cannot survive too many day-night cycles. The zero pressure balloon is an open balloon. They lose gas during the night. When during the night and they lose gas, they lose altitude, and they drop ballasters to keep the balloon stay up. And during the day, they can stay up there. They go in too many cycles, they lose too much gas, then they couldn't stay up anymore. At the high latitudes during the summer season, and it's daylight all the time. So that way, you don't have a day-night cycle anymore. And NASA is working on a super pressure balloon, which should be able to cross oceans. And NASA is talking about maybe in the future launching a super pressure balloon from McMurdo. Let it fly over to New Zealand, recovery in New Zealand. That would be something very nice to look into.
And the wind, measured wind, do you consider correction due to the balloon movement itself, like vertically or horizontally?
Horizontally, yes. These winds are like the balloon travel speed is about like 10 meters, something like that, per second, something like that. So that's almost like a wind errors we have. But yes, we can. We do take them out, and we have a GPS and receivers on them, and we can track the locations all the time. The GPS compass also give us speed and heading as well. So in all these high wind data, we also taking out all these balloon motion, all we've been taking out, has been taken out.
So in principle, you could measure in-situ gravity waves too, probably?
Yes. If that is a one application, but not with a zero pressure balloons. And you probably should use super pressure balloons to do that. And that's what the experiment NCAR involved with a French group did. The zero pressure balloon is a little bit difficult because you have a drop ballasters or other things. So the vertical motion of the balloon is not purely due to the gravity waves, due to your human controls sometimes.
Okay, no more questions. Let's thank Qian again.